Hi, I'm Marc Eliot, writer, biographer, author of several books about popular culture. I'm happy to be back here at Eureka College speaking tonight, and I look forward to it and seeing all my friends from my previous visit and my meeting up with several graduates and faculty all over the country. So, thank you, and I hope you enjoy our little discussion here.
Mark, thank you for being back at Eureka College. You've written your latest book, your 26th book, on Charlton Heston. Tell us about the book.
Well, it's the definitive biography. I started it almost 3 years ago, and after I was into it for about 8 months, I decided to call the family and see if I could get their cooperation without surrendering any editorial rights, because once you do that, it's no longer a biography, it's hagiography. So they looked at my work, they saw that I usually don't have an agenda, I just become a detective and try to tell what I learn, and they agreed. And when that happened, everything about the book changed, deepened, got more complex, and at the same time, simpler, because the illumination behind the life of Charlton Heston, it was kind of like turning on a projector and the screen suddenly brightening up before the film begins. It was a great journey. Fraser Heston was a font of information and not afraid to share anything that I asked for. Charlton Heston was a pretty good writer in his own place, and he kept journals beginning, I think, with the Ten Commandments right up until the end of his life, until he could no longer do it. I guess the last great journal entry was the letter he wrote to the public in the style of Ronald Reagan, informing them that this was going to be a journey for him that would have only one ending, and that he had a great life and he was so grateful for all the people, and that he was concerned more with how his family would be affected than how he would. So, I mean, these are all giants that I write about. The more I got into the Heston story, the more I realized two things. The first thing is that the NRA situation was so amplified and so put out of proportion that it smothered. It was like a gigantic dark cloud that smothered the sunshine, the rest of Heston's important life, both on screen and off. And the other thing I realized that I have always known but tend to sometimes forget is how primitive and undeveloped film scholarship is. You know, we take film for granted in this country more than in other countries, and because the median age of people who actually go out to a movie has dropped so drastically, that now it's mostly, not completely, but mostly in the realm of teenagers and young couples, and they want to see action movies and all that stuff on the big screen, which is fine. I have nothing wrong with those films. But it tends to leave so-called classic films to someplace you have to seek out, whether it's a classic film television station or film festivals or revival houses. I mean, that is really where you find these films, and you don't always have them at your fingertips. Going along with that is the fact that people tend to write about film in a different way than they write about art. You can pick up a so-called serious film book, and it's, you know, he went out with this one, then they got divorced, then he went out with this one, and then he took this vacation there, and he bought this and he bought that. And film kind of gets lost in the mix, the art of film. Whereas if you pick up a book about Picasso or Rembrandt or anybody, even Andy Warhol, there is a wealth of material, not just about the subject, but about what they did, about their art. And part of that is Hollywood's fault, and part of it isn't. When Hollywood began, it turned film out the way Hershey turns out chocolate bars. They don't turn them out for posterity, for prosperity. They turn them out for consummation, so that you consume them, you throw them away, and you get another one. So the way the studio system was structured, they made films, they distributed films, and they exhibited films. They owned the theaters, the studios. So there was a constant turnover. There were no cassettes, there were no DVDs, there were very few revival houses, there was no television. So the idea was, you make a movie like a Hershey bar. You sell it to the consumer, they eat it, they throw the wrapper away, and every Wednesday, two new movies in each theater. And usually in the so-called golden age, there were five or six theaters in every town. So you could go to the movies every night. And because there was no TV, a lot of people did. They would have dinner, go to the movies, come home. Next night, go to work, come home, dinner. Hey, let's go see that great film, even if they saw one, even if they saw half of one. And then, when that run ended, those films had no more commercial value. So they were packed up carelessly in tin cans and stored. And if you know, a feature-length film has seven or eight of these big cans, maybe more. And that takes space, and space is money. So the more they stockpile these films without pulling them, the more deterioration set in. So how bad was it? 80% of silent films were lost. So if you wanted to do scholarship about the early days of Hollywood, it'd be impossible. It's a kind of a lost, neglected art, a huge commercial art. But in terms of criticism and scholarship and culture and creativity and something that is indigenous to America, it's almost impossible. So when I write my books, I try to make in the foreground the subject of the book, and in the background, a history of Hollywood that you really usually don't get. And that's why my books, sometimes people say, well, they're too academic for journalism, and they're too journalistic for academia. And I like that, because I don't want my books just to be read by scholars. I want them to be read by people who go to the movies, who like the movies. And so I kind of sugarcoat the medicine a little bit with a style that I think is easy to read, although the material sometimes is complex. And in this book that just came out, the Charlton Heston book, with the benefit of the Academy Film Library in Beverly Hills, the New York Performing Arts Library at Lincoln Center in New York, the family archives that were just so crucial to this project, I think I put together something that when you read it, you think you know who Charlton Heston was, and you may know a little bit, oh yeah, Moses, oh that guy, but you will learn something about him and about Hollywood that will hopefully be a revelation to you.
You're back here at the alma mater of a famous classic Hollywood actor and future president of the United States, Ronald Wilson Reagan. There was a relationship between Ronald Reagan and Charlton Heston. There are comparatives, there are contrasts. Can you talk about Reagan and Heston?
Well, Reagan joined the Screen Actors Guild in the 40s when there wasn't a lot of work for actors because of the war. The government took over most of the studios and had them make what amounted to propaganda films. And Reagan's main employment in those days, in the war years, was narrating these films, sometimes on screen, sometimes off screen, and they were meant to teach soldiers, teach recruits the ins and outs of preparation, and also to inspire people in the country to build some patriotic fervor, which was needed always, and to soothe the people left behind that, you know, that everything will be all right. So in his free time, he started going to SAG meetings, Screen Actors Guild, which is the guild that takes care of actors. It's their union. And because he was such a natural politician, I think even more so than a natural actor, he was a natural politician, he kind of rose to the top rather quickly. And before 1945, he was the president of the Screen Actors Guild. Then when 4 or 5 years later, when Heston came to Hollywood, Reagan saw something in him, saw a leadership quality, and asked him if he would join the board of directors for the Screen Actors Guild. And Heston did. And in the years that followed, up until the time that Reagan left performing and left the Screen Actors Guild, he mentored Heston to be his heir. And even though there were two other people who served, eventually Heston took over as president. He was elected president of the union and served 6 consecutive terms. Now, why is that important in terms of Reagan and Heston? Well, the Screen Actors Guild was generally acknowledged to be the springboard into politics. George Murphy, who was a previous president, became a senator in California. Reagan, of course, went on to become president of Berkeley, and then governor, and then president. So when Heston came aboard and became president, there was a feeling in the Republican Party that he was going to be Reagan's heir at the White House. If Reagan had an 8-year run, which he did, Heston, who was 10 or 15 years younger, would be the natural heir. And interestingly enough, the Democratic Party also thought that he would make a perfect candidate. You know, he had been a Democrat most of his life and marched with Martin Luther King and supported JFK. And as he got older and he moved to the right, both parties felt that he would have been a great president. And they approached him several times, and his answer was similar to something that Ronald Reagan had said, which was, I can't afford the cut and pay. And then he said that, you know, he was an actor. He said, I'm an actor. And what he meant, I think, was that the difference between Reagan and Heston boiled down to its essence is that Heston was a politician who loved acting. Heston was an actor who loved politics. So that really is the difference between the two of them. And, you know, Reagan inspired Heston. There was a lot to look up to there. And yet when, in Reagan's first year, when he decided to cut the arts budget, most of the money for the council and all the arts programs, Heston went to Washington and lobbied for those programs, because a lot of the money that went to the American Film Institute came from that money. And Reagan, to his credit, listened. They negotiated and eventually put back 80% of that money and got it from somewhere else. Now, why is that important? Well, for a lot of reasons, which I will sum up briefly for you. It showed that Reagan was someone who you could deal with, you could talk to, you could make a case for, and he wasn't someone who stood on that principle. So, and that again is why Reagan was such a good politician, because he knew what he was doing. The second thing is that that money was needed for, among many other things, the American Film Institute. What is the American Film Institute? It's a nonprofit organization in Hollywood whose first goal was film preservation. When they began in the late 70s, their goal was to get these films out of those cans where they were deteriorating on a daily basis and save Hollywood's history. So crucial. The second thing is that the AFI is a school for actors, directors, and screenwriters. And what's unique about them and different from all the other schools that teach various aspects of film is that they wanted to use professional people in their projects. So a student filmmaker could go to an actor and say, would you be in my film? Now, there was a rule in the Screen Actors Guild that prevented that. There's a rule that says you cannot work for nothing, that you have to work in a union-sanctioned film and you must get paid. And of course, that's what the Screenwriters Guild had fought for years, including all the Reagan years. He was crucial to maintaining that. But Heston knew that 92% of actors in the Screen Actors Guild don't work. And he thought, well, this would give them a chance to practice their craft and also to have a product at the end of it that they could use as a showcase when these films were shown. So it was Heston who got the funding restored for the AFI and got a waiver from the Screen Actors Guild that allowed actors to work in films made by the AFI, as did the Screen Actors Guild, Screenwriters Guild, and the Directors Guild. So all of that came about as a result of Reagan mentoring Heston and Heston taking up the mantle to preserve Hollywood. So it's a great story and something that a lot of people don't realize. You know, there's a tendency to think that, you know, Reagan sat around and watched old movies and didn't care about Hollywood. He cared. He made it possible for the AFI to remain in existence. And of course, today, film preservation, all that's going on, Martin Scorsese and Robert De Niro, all of that comes from what they did together.
You talked about Reagan being a politician who loved acting and Heston being an actor who loved politics. Just back to that point for a minute. The latter part of Heston's career, and your book addresses this, Heston's respect for and love of the constitutional Second Amendment right to bear arms manifests itself in his own leadership of the largest association lobbying to preserve Second Amendment rights, the NRA, National Rifle Association. Can you talk about how that came about? What was the impetus for his respect for the Second Amendment, and how did it come about that he lent his name and actually became a part of an organization for the latter part of his career?
Well, it's not very well known, but Heston saw action in the Second World War. He was stationed in the Aleutians and he trained as a radio man, so he went on dozens of missions against the Japanese in the Pacific. And doing that instilled in him a sense of right and wrong. We are fighting to preserve freedom. There was no kind of vagueness about the war or we want to turn them into the... No. We were fighting to preserve our right, the Constitution, freedom. Those were his goals. You know, he went into the army as a boy, a college boy. He came out as a man. It matured him in every way and made him a better actor when he went into acting and made him a better leader of the Screen Actors Guild because he never lost the bigger picture, which is this is about freedom. And so when the NRA approached him in the mid-80s, several things came together. First of all, the NRA was almost bankrupt. They were losing popularity. They didn't have any funding. So they got the idea that what they needed was a public face on the NRA, someone who could bring people to meetings, to rallies, and to membership. Heston at the time, who was now in his 60s, and primarily an action character, as opposed to a leading man, was starting to, get up there a little bit, and jumping over mountains and all that became a little more difficult for him, and so did roles. So one thing he loved to do was perform. He loved audiences. You know, he was primarily a stage actor. So when the NRA invited him to a rally, he saw all these people there. They weren't there because they were members of the NRA. They were there because Charlton Heston was there. That did something to him, and it did something to Tony Macris, who was the head of the organization that was leading the public relations campaign. Macris said to Heston, you are so right for this, and look at the response. If you want to, we will set up all these places that you can go. We'll give you your own plane. We'll make it very easy for you. Just get off the plane, go to a rally, we'll get you home. It was very appealing to Heston because those crowds were something that he loved. So he said, okay. And for the next 8 or 9 years, he went to every rally they asked him to go to. And the membership of the NRA exploded. People just were able to connect Heston, Constitution, Second Amendment, NRA. And that's really what happened. When that last rally that everybody always remembers, the cloud, the dark cloud, the over my dead hands, first of all, it wasn't spontaneous. The speech was written out. Secondly, that phrase had been used many, many times in movies. There are plenty of movies that use it. The Blues Brothers, in the Blues Brothers, somebody says, my cold dead hands. But the moment has a tinge of sadness about it because it's probably the first or the very beginning of the Alzheimer's disease that allowed him to lose that control and confuse the role of the spokesman with being some kind of movie role. And while those symptoms aren't immediately apparent, doctors are now saying that that probably was the beginning of it. Not to make any excuses. I mean, he was certainly capable of, if somebody put a gun in his hand and said, shoot that person, you have a right to, he wouldn't do it. But this appealed to him. He thought it was the right thing to do. And one of the really interesting things I found out about him was that he never regretted what he did. He never said, oh, what did I do? Or I'm sorry I got involved with the NRA. That wasn't Heston. He knew that it was unpopular, and he was willing to pay that price for something he believed in. And what I try to do in the book is not to take sides, not to say this was great or this was awful, but to give you a chance to make up your own mind as opposed to screaming headlines, the press, or whatever, to let you see what it was, and then make up your own mind.
Last question. Charlton Heston summed up in a paragraph or two his life and his meaning as an American icon, as an icon of Hollywood.
Most careers in Hollywood for men in on screen last about 8 or 9 years. For women, it's even less. It's 4 or 5 years, and it's the all about Eve syndrome. There's always somebody younger, prettier, better looking, stronger, whatever you want to put on that. Heston's career lasted over 50 years. When you have somebody who has that kind of staying power, it tells you something about his effect, the impression he made on America. He spent his whole life searching for his own identity, for reconstructing some of the early childhood traumas he experienced, That turned him into an even better family man. And he represented to most Americans an image of Americans and America larger than life. And that is something that will stay his image for as long as there's movies in America.
The book is Charlton Heston, Hollywood's Last Icon, by you, Marc Eliot.
That's right.
We're honored to call you our friend at Eureka College and the Ronald Reagan Society, and thank you for visiting.
Well, I'm honored to call you my friend.
Thank you, Marc.
Okay.